Hey everybody, it's Magus. Thanks for coming back for our February 2023 update for our Tesla solar panels and Powerwall system. It's been an exciting month. Electric, Teslarati, and Drive Tesla wrote a couple articles about our virtual power plant compensation check. I'll go into that in a little bit, but it's a very exciting time for solar and battery storage. There's also a magazine article that's going to be coming out this month that I'd like you to read. I'll let you know about that when it happens. Very excited for it. But speaking of the virtual power plant, what we got this month was our compensation check. So you can see there, $574.77. So that's about $20 less than I expected. I predicted $594. We sent back about 300 kilowatt hours to the grid. Basically, that $20 reduction just means that we were sending back about a kilowatt hour to the grid during those events. There were 10 events, 10 kilowatt hours times $2 per kilowatt hour is that $20 difference. As you can see, it's a pretty hefty check. I mean, that is a month and a half of our payments for the entire system. So that does pretty well. One kind of thing that bothers me is Tesla just sends you a blank memo with a check that just says VPP payment. That's the only notation that you're getting a payment for the VPP. A little bit annoying. There's no calculation of, you know, why you're getting the amount that you're getting, but that's just the way it is. Hopefully we'll get that information at some point, maybe not. Other things that happened this month is that Tesla updated the app. As you can see here, there's a little bit different animations. Now basically solar is gonna come down as yellow. It's all gonna go through your inverter and power walls here in the app, as you can see, a little bit more realistic. And then depending on what you're using, if it's coming from the battery, that flow is gonna be green. If it's coming directly from solar, that flow is gonna be yellow to the house, or if it's going to the grid, it's gonna be gray. So just a little aesthetically different, but a little more realistic. It's a great update. The only other thing that happened here is that PG&E sent us a letter at the beginning of February that said they were going to be doing a power pole replacement. This letter, I don't have a copy of it with me, but this letter actually said you're going to need to shut off any generators, etc., that you have hooked up because the power is going to go off. I'm kind of curious about this. I figured that probably going the off-grid mode should be okay. However, off-grid has a little caveat saying that, you know, if something happens, there's an error with the system, it will go back onto the grid. So I'm not sure if that would have been sufficient or if we would have needed to completely shut down the system, turn the panels off and everything. PG&E ended up canceling that power pole replacement for us, so that didn't end up being an issue, but just something to think of for the future. Well, with that going on, let's take a look at the data for this month. Here we go. So the first thing we're gonna look at this month is house usage. We used 763.1 kilowatt hours in February. That's up from last February where we used 659 kilowatt hours. We're basically getting a lot colder February and a lot more rain here, so we're using the heat more. In addition, with a baby in the family now, we're running the dishwasher pretty much every day, doing a lot more laundry than we used to. So that kind of explains our increased usage. Now compare this to January, where we used 842.1 kilowatt hours, as you can see. Now basically, when you look at this, February is just a shorter month. The averages there on the bottom are about the same for those. So if you added those 3 days, they're pretty much going to be the same thing. But looking at these graphs here, look at the beginning and the end, they're gray. So I've kind of changed my position here. We weren't getting storm watch for any of these atmospheric river events, and we tend to get these blips in powers or power cutoffs when it rains and it's pretty windy, which is what happens during these events. So I changed ours from normally running at 0% backup to 100% backup. I wanted the full protection in case something happened, just because we weren't getting much production. If I didn't set that backup level up to 100%, we'd use what we got from solar during the day. Basically, once that's gone and there's no solar to produce during the day, no storm watch to charge from the grid, we just have empty power walls, which are useless. So that was the reasoning in my decision. You know, it seemed to work out. We just had a couple little blips, so I really didn't need to do it, but for peace of mind, made me feel a lot better. The next thing we're going to look at here is solar production, and it was 864.2 kilowatt hours in February, and that's down about 22% from February of last year, which was 1116 kilowatt hours. This is all weather. Last year, February, there was no weather, as you can see in the graphs here, basically just a straight graph up for the most part. This year, we had those atmospheric rivers. They came at the end of the month too, and you tend to be producing the most. So those 4 or 5 days in February really knocked us down quite a bit. It's unfortunate, but for the Sacramento area here where it's sunny for most of the year, it's just a fact of life. You're gonna get some weather. We don't get it nearly as much as anybody else, so not bad at all. Now looking at last month, January, we also had atmospheric rivers in the end of December and then the first 2 weeks of January. So January, we produced 612.1 kilowatt hours. That weather just really knocks down that production. It's just normal, you know, in these times around in the Sacramento, Northern California area for this kind of rainy season. I'm not too worried about it. It just kind of is what it is. Coming up next is going to be Powerwall stats. In February, we used 345.8 kilowatt hours, and that is down from 409 kilowatt hours in February. This basically can be explained again by that 100% backup setting that I had used, essentially just having max protection during those storms, but we didn't use it towards the end of the month. So you can see there's just that decline at the end of the month where they weren't being used. Now looking at January was 209 kilowatt hours, which is, you know, quite a bit less too. Again, for the most part, we were on vacation in the beginning and that atmospheric river, so the backup set to 100%, just not gonna use those power walls at all. Again, it's kind of weird that the storm watch didn't activate during these events. It used to be pretty sensitive with the weather alerts and everything going off, but recently with these, you know, wind and rain events, it hasn't been going off, so I've just been setting it manually. I don't know if they've adjusted when they trigger or not. I know I complained about it being a little sensitive on high winds last summer, but I think I'm taking that back. I wish it was a bit more sensitive. Hopefully we'll see a change here. Only other thing with the power walls, and you can see here, just had two small blips this month. They were both under a minute when they happened. Beauty of the power wall is nothing turns off, everything keeps on going. So didn't even really notice they happened. And the last one is going to be net grid use. In January, we were at 268 kilowatt hours positive, as is one of those low production months. You know, other than December, it's the lowest production month, so we're gonna use a lot. February, negative 28.7 kilowatt hours. Basically in mid-January, as you can see in these graphs here, we started to get to a point where we can be self-sufficient. During December and January, we don't get to those points. We're just not producing enough. For us, it's about 35 kilowatt hours during the day to cover our house usage and then to recharge the power walls to get them back to a place where, you know, we can run off the power walls and off the grid completely. So that happens in mid-January there. Once we generally get to that point in mid-January, we don't hit the grid, you know, routinely until that November-December period. So looking forward here, that negative 28.7 going forward should be a lot back to the grid. Last year we were at negative 387 kilowatt hours. One, that's amazing. Two, I mean, pretty much we had 250 kilowatt hours less production because of the weather this year, so that explains away a lot of it. Our usage was about 100 kilowatt hours or so higher, you know, with the increased laundry and the baby and the family. So that can kind of be explained away. It's just a really good month last year too. So it is what it is. You know, sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't. Well, I hope you enjoyed this month. Hopefully you found it interesting. If there's anything that you have a comment on, anything I can do better, anything that you want to see, let me know in the comments. As always, if you need a referral, look down below. You can use my referral link. That'll get you points for the Tesla shop, so you can get goodies, software, full self-driving, etc. Please subscribe. Enjoy. Have a good one.